السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. All praise for Allah, Lord of the worlds, and peace and blessings be upon Prophet Muhammad, his companions, and all those who strive to follow in their footsteps. Welcome, my dear viewers, brothers, and sisters, to another episode of Quran and Science brought to you from Huda TV. My name is Sharif Tuni, and in this episode, we'll be discussing bringing to you more about the fertilizing winds and how it helps in producing rain and also in the pollination of flowers and plants. And for this discussion, we have with us Professor of Geology Zaghloul Nagar with us in the show. Assalamu alaikum and welcome to the show.
Assalamu alaikum.
I'd also like to introduce my dear brothers and guests in this episode for questions and interaction with Dr. Zaghloul. We have with us Abdurrahman Ismail and Zabihullah Kareem.
Thank you.
Before we move to discussion about this topic of the fertilizing winds and how it causes rain to descend from the sky and also to cause the pollination of flowers and plants, I'll leave you now with this verse from the Holy Surah Al-Hijr, and then we'll return back, so stay tuned.
وأرسلنا الرياح لواقح فأنزلنا من السماء ماء فأسقيناكموه وما أنتم له بخازنين.
We send the fertilizing winds and cause rain to descend from the sky for you to drink. It is not you who hold its reserves.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome back. You're watching Quran and Science. And love first to know from my brothers what they got from this verse. So I'll start now by Abdurrahman Ismail, the meaning that you're getting from behind this holy verse.
The verse actually explains some of the roles of the wind, like carrying the pollen from flower to flower, which is a process of pollination. As far as I understand, and also the role of the wind to move clouds from a place to a place.
Yes. Okay. Zabihullah?
Yeah, all I get it is that Allah who control everything, Allah who control and send the wind and send the clouds through this wind from place to place where the places that need for rains and send down the water.
It's a beautiful meaning of, yes. And it's a very precise way of doing things around us.
Yeah.
We should be looking at this and saying, Subhanallah.
It's an invitation for meditation and
yes.
Contemplation.
Just by admiring this nature and how it happens,
yeah.
The process
Subhanallah.
Happens. Subhanallah. Okay, moving now to Professor Zaghloul, and the two parts were in this verse. One of them is وَأَرْسَلْنَا الرِّيَاحَ لَوَاقِحَ, and the other was a very important point that we discussed in a previous episode. It's about the rain, and that we the human cannot maintain rain or have it in reserves or anything. So we'd like to know from you the scientific notation from this holy verse about how to have this fertilizing winds.
I begin by thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and praising all his messengers and prophets and their sincere followers, and by greeting you all in our Islamic way. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May Allah's peace, blessings and mercy be with you all. Again, this is a living example for the scientific precision of every notion in the glorious Quran. The verse reads, وَأَرْسَلْنَا الرِّيَاحَ لَوَاقِحَ. We have sent the rain as a fertilizing agent. Who sends the wind? We have sent the wind, the winds as fertilizing agents. The verse reads, وَأَرْسَلْنَا الرِّيَاحَ لَوَاقِحَ. Verily, we have sent the winds as a fertilizing agent. Fertilizing to what? And who sends the wind other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? First of all, we have to realize the fact that the variation of the degree of temperature in the atmosphere of the different zones is one of the ways of allowing wind to travel from one area to the other. Areas with high temperature are described as areas of low pressure. and they are areas of depression, as they call them. Areas with cold wind are considered to be areas of high pressure, areas of activity of the wind, you see. So usually we have wind moving from high pressure areas to low pressure areas. But of course, this process is not that simple, because we get the involvement of the rotation of the Earth around its own axis.
Of course. You see, that makes it complicated.
Complicated matters, you see. We have currents going from down upwardly, not just horizontally. We have wind currents that go from, if the ground is so heated, then you get the air would move upwardly. And then when it cools, it will come down again. So the process is highly complicated. It's not that simple. And we have very many factors that control the process of wind movement. And this is done according to a divine plan that sustains life on the surface of that planet. So we have to believe that the main force behind the movement of wind is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَأَرْسَلْنَا الرِّيَاحَ لَوَاقِحَ. The very simple impression people got from لواقح, they thought it's the pollination of flowers.
Yes.
Because the wind can carry some pollens and spores from one plant to the other. And this will help in the fertilization of these flowers and the production of various fruits and various vegetables and various seeds. And which is correct. Nobody can deny this. But only recently we came to discover the fact that this inoculation also happens to the clouds themselves.
Yes.
The water vapor in the cloud is so thin that it cannot be pulled down by gravity. You have to increase the amount of water vapor around a nucleus. And that's why we have inoculation of the clouds by dust particles, by minute salt particles that are carried from the sea, by some pollens and spores themselves, you see. Or around these nuclei, water starts to condense until it reaches a certain weight that can pull it down by gravity. And that's why the winds actually play a very, very important role in the process of rain formation and raindrop.
So this was a recent study, how the inoculation happens by the wind to the clouds?
Because the wind usually, as it moves, it rubs the ground surface.
Yes.
And as this rubbing goes on from one area to the other, wind becomes actually charged by minute dust particles, minute pollens and spores, minute flakes of salt, and the like, you see. And by the will of Allah, when these reach the cloud, it becomes the inoculation or the centers of condensation of water vapor to form a larger drops of water that can come down by gravity. Mm-hmm. So if Allah says that 14 centuries ago, this is a new knowledge that was only gained in the 20th century. And if Allah says that the wind is inoculating clouds 14 centuries ago, this is a living testimony that the Quran cannot be the work of man. It's the word of the Creator in its divine purity.
SubhanAllah. And the pollination of plants, how precise it happens, also using the wind to have the pollens to different flowers and different
you
plants?
You see, we have in the plants, we have plants that are either males or females. And unless the pollens and spores will be carried from one sex to the other, no fertilization can take place. Of course, insects play a very important role, particularly the bees. Yes, mm-hmm. can play a role in that. But also the wind can play a very important role. Mm-hmm. And sometimes we get in the same plant, you get a male flower and a female flower. And then again, both insects and wind can play a role of fertilizing the female flower by the spores of the male flower. So both wind and insects play the main role in the fertilization of most plants. But to me, the verse here comes mainly in the context of inoculating nuclei of condensation within the cloud body so that the water vapor can be condensed easily, and this water drops can increase in volume and in weight so that they can be pulled down by gravity.
So the focus here is only on this part, not on the pollination of plants.
No, it also covers that.
As I mean.
But because the verse speaks about clouds,
yes,
you see, it makes the reflection more on the inoculation or fertilization of the clouds rather than the simple fertilization of plants, although the two processes can go in one go.
In one time.
And okay. Go together.
Okay, and what would we think from the second part of this verse, وما أنتم له بخزنين?
Yes.
In a previous episode, we spoke about how a human can't reserve,
yes,
and is not able also to do artificial rain. And as,
yes,
you mentioned in the previous episodes,
yes,
there was a failing experiences or failing experiments,
yes,
of having,
yes,
artificial rain. So I need you to do some stressing on this part of the verse.
You see, we know today that 97.5% of all the water on our globe are in oceans and seas. And what man makes use of is only 2.5%. More than half of that amount is stored as ice sheets at the two poles of the earth and at the peaks of mountains. The other half, the greatest bulk of it, is groundwater. And on this groundwater, many countries, many lives actually exist and survive.
And how deep is this groundwater?
It varies from place to place. Mm-hmm. It can go down to 1,000 meters.
Yes, you see, reachable to human.
Yes, but...
I mean, the reserves entirely is reachable to human.
Yes, but it can be within a few meters to,
yes,
over 1,000 meters,
yes,
you see. Because we mentioned earlier that the Earth... temperature increases gradually with depth.
Exactly.
So if you exceed 1,000 meters or reach a zone of high temperature, water is evaporated and can go into chemical reactions and you can never get anything out of it.
Mm-hmm.
So the process of storing groundwater in the outer rocky layer of the earth or in the soil is a miracle that testifies to the might, knowledge, and wisdom of the Creator. As we mentioned earlier, the groundwater represents the bulk of the fluid water on the surface of our planet. All that flows in rivers is less than 0.2%. People quarrel about water in the rivers and try to fight with each other for flowing rivers and waters. It's only 0.2%. The bulk of the fresh water in a fluid form is the stored water in the ground. And this storage is a miracle by itself, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has caused in the composition of the outer rocky layer of the earth simple alternation between highly porous and highly permeable rocks and impervious and non-porous rocks. And once you get an outcrop for a porous bed, once this receives rain water can penetrate the pores of this rock and can flow with it, with the depth of the bed, until it reaches a point when the porosity is lost and becomes stored there. And becomes an aquifer, means a stored amount of water that can be used by people later on. And by the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we have great climatic changes. Not all rainy areas, you see, are enjoying rain all the time.
Yes.
Not all desert areas are remaining desert all the time. We get alternation of these cycles out of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah can store water for desert areas, you see, at a time when they are having rain, and can store water for highly rainy areas at times when they change into deserts. So this process, again, testifies for the knowledge, wisdom, and might of the Creator, because if you don't have stored water in the ground, in desert areas, no life can exist.
SubhanAllah. We now move for a very short break and return back for more discussion about this topic of fertilizing winds.
Oh. Al-Qudr is going to be changing its days. We're moving from Friday to Sunday. So Al-Qudr is now going to be on Sundays and on Tuesdays from 15th of April 2008. So put it in your diary, Al-Qudr on Sundays and Tuesdays. Stay with us on Huda TV, a light in every home.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome back. You're watching Quran and Science. And now we move for some questions about this topic. So I'll first start with Abdurrahman Ismail.
I notice in many verses of the Quran, when Allah talks about wind, He talks about wind in plural when it's good wind, and in singular when it's like a bad wind. So does this have a scientific connotation?
The question is, I'd like to ask you, to, because you have a long question, so can you repeat the question, raising your voice?
Okay. When Allah talks about wind, He talks about wind in plural when it's good wind.
Yes.
And in singular form when it's bad wind. Does this have any scientific connotation?
You see, this is very true, and this was explained by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allahumma ij'alha riyahan wa la taj'alha riyahan. Oh Allah, make it a plural form of winds rather than a single wind. Because usually when you have a single wind, and a wind directed into a single direction, it becomes a very destructive force. If you have winds coming from different directions, this is the norm Allah has played or has established for this planet. So really, when the Prophet said that Allahumma ij'alha riyahan wa la taj'alha riyahan, is again a testimony to the knowledge Allah has given to that Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam through revelation. If you have a single directed wind, it can be a very destructive element. If you have a multiplicity of wind directions, they can minimize the dangers of each other and can be a benefit for humanity rather than a form of punishment. And that's why usually singly directed winds are instructed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as a means of punishment for certain people like the people of Ad, for example, and we will come to that inshallah in another episode.
We know that when there is a punishment, there must be like a scientific reason for for moving the wind. I mean, we know that the pressure. Maybe it is a pressure that controls the direction of the wind, but what controls the speed of the wind? Is it the pressure as well?
You see, the pressure plays a role in the speed of the wind, but again, the state of the area where the wind is directed. You see, if you are moving from a high pressure zone to a low pressure zone, the difference in pressure is a very important factor in shaping and directing the speed of the wind. If you, the two zones are almost equal, you see, then the movement will be very slow. But if the gap between one area and another is great, the speed will be very high.
But,
yes,
small question. We know that water comes from the wind. It's composed of two
atoms. Water comes from the wind?
So I mean from the air, from two atoms of hydrogen and oxygen. Is it possible that the amount of water could increase on the expense of air or the reverse?
No, because you see the percentage of humidity in the air is very small. But it's very essential for life. If you live in a completely dry air, one would die because he will start losing the water in his body to that dry air. And that's why one of the great mercies of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the humidity of the air. And this humidity is something in the range of 0.002%, for example. It's very, very small, but it's very essential for life.
Okay.
Yeah, my question is, Professor, in some areas we notice that when clouds come, so we after that we see that winds are coming and push these clouds from this area. Maybe there is some reason for that. The rain is not useful for that land, or what would be the wisdom?
You see, people usually when they see cloud coming, they have the glad tiding, yani, that the rain will come, you see. But nobody can control it.
Yeah.
It may come to your place and then pass you and go and drop somewhere else. So really, we as Muslims have to believe 100% that the only power that can send down rain is the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And no other factor can have any saying in that. Wallahi, I was traveling once in a plane within America, the USA, and by the grace of Allah, I found next to me immediately was a professor of climatology. And I asked him that question, yani, can you really control rain? He said, no. He said, until this moment, although we have very many information about how rain is formed, we cannot control it, and we do not know many other factors which are hidden to us up until this moment. So nobody can control rain dropping from the sky other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Okay, another question is, that does the rainwater contain the same minerals like the groundwater have, or is it that much useful for drinking as the groundwater?
I can't follow you clearly.
Please repeat your question.
Yeah, the question is that does the rainwater contains the same minerals like the groundwater?
No, definitely not. The Quran says repeatedly, وَنْزَلْنَا مِيَا سَمَاءِ مَاءً مُبَارَكًا وَنْزَلْنَا مِيَا سَمَاءِ مَاءً طَهُورًا. We have sent down from rain a blessed water. We have sent down from rain a purified water. And nowadays, the groundwater, the more it remains in the ground, the more it will dissolve salts. And it can reach a degree of salinity much greater than the seawater, see, by the passage of time. See, but the rainwater is absolutely free, fresh water. And scientists admit today that the purest water in nature we know of is the rainwater. The purest water we know of is the rainwater. And of course you can distill water and get 100% purity. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends that rain with the least amount of salts, out of the solvent chemical compounds in it. And that's why he shows his bounties upon us. وَنْزَلْنَا مِيَا سَمَاءِ مَاءً طَهُورًا. We have sent down to you from sky a purified form of water. And this is a blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
So rain is actually a form of distillation, right?
It's a process of distillation, but of course, as the rain is coming down, it can dissolve some of the chemical compounds in the atmosphere. And that's why Allah in Surah Al-Waqi'ah, you see, says, أَفَرَأَيْتُمُ الْمَاءَ الَّذِي تَشْرَبُونَ أَأَنْتُمْ أَنْزَلْتُمُوهُ مِنَ الْمُزْنِ أَمْ نَحْنُ الْمُنْزِلُونَ لَوْ نَشَاءُ جَعَلْنَاهُ أُجَاجًا فَلَوْلَا تَشْكُرُونَ. He said, do you see this water which you drink? Were it you who caused it to come down from the clouds? It's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أَنْتُمْ أَنْزَلْتُمُوهُ مِنَ الْمُزْنِ أَمْ نَحْنُ الْمُنْزِلُونَ لَوْ نَشَاءُ جَعَلْنَاهُ أُجَاجًا فَلَوْلَا تَشْكُرُونَ. Without thanking, without being thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah, if He wills, He can make it impotable, completely impotable. And imagine if the percentage of carbon dioxide or sulfur dioxide is increased a fraction of 10,000 in the atmosphere, rainwater could have never been suitable for drinking. It would have been virtually impotable. And in many industrialized countries, we hear about what they call the acid rain. You see, due to the excess amount of carbon dioxide or sulfur dioxide or nitrogen dioxide in the atmosphere, the rain comes acidic, and they call it acid rain. And this acid water can kill plants, can kill humans, can kill animals, because nobody can drink it. It's virtually impotable. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is showing His bounties upon us by sending down rain in a purified form, and He calls it ma'an tahura, ma'an mubaraka, blessed water or a purified water.
Professor Zaghloul, sorry, Azabihullah, if we move back to the topic, the different types of winds and the levels of winds.
Yes.
And the standard of leveling in the wind.
Of course, you see, wind near the surface of the earth is definitely more effective than wind in the upper layers of the atmosphere. And you cannot have wind above the troposphere zone. Wind is usually in the lower atmosphere or the troposphere, a distance of 8 to 18 kilometers above sea level, no more than that. Because you cannot get anything due to the drop of pressure as you go high in the atmosphere.
Okay, your question?
Yeah, so my question is, because of pollution nowadays, the water is not, the rain is not going to pollute it in while it's coming.
It is polluted, definitely. The more you pollute the atmosphere, the more polluted the rainwater will come down. Because part and parcel of the process. You see, if you pollute the atmosphere, you are bound to pollute the rain. And the dropping down of acid rain in highly in the industrialized countries is a product of this. You pollute the rainwater.
All right, Professor Zaghloul Naggar, thank you very much for being here. It was a very informative episode. It was a pleasure to have you. And I also like to thank Abdurrahman Ismail and Zabihullah Karim for being here with us. Dear viewers, with this we come to the end of this episode of Quran Science. See you in the coming edition. Thanks for watching. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.